and Dilly MacFarlane. Welcome to In Town. Today it's my pleasure to invite Peter Schwenger and Susan Stainton to give us a little look at the Mount Playhouse, a production of Mount St. Vincent University that's been ongoing now for 6 years. I'm going to start with you, Peter. What's your background in theater? I know that you've done all sorts of different things in the theater world, and tell us a little bit about what you've done before you started with the Mount Playhouse.
How far back do you want me to go?
Within living memory.
Well, within my living memory, it really started with my fifth Christmas when my grandmother in Vienna sent me a red and gold puppet theater. And that puppet theater became the center of my childhood. I was producing plays, very elaborate plays, designing sets, costumes, lighting, and inflicting them on my long-suffering parents until it got embarrassing. About 13, you know, you don't continue to play with dolls at that point, and I had to graduate to the real thing. I went on to high school drama and then college drama, much endangering my academic average, I might add. And then even in graduate school, when most people just grow out of this, I got involved with the dramat that the undergrads were doing and helped out and began directing then. And then there was a long lapse of about 7 years until I got to the Mount, and the Mount resurrected me.
Well, that was the summer of 1982, was it not? The first year of the Mount Playhouse?
That was the first year of the Mount Playhouse.
But you had actually been involved in Mount productions before that.
Well, Renata Usmiani dug me out of my office. She's a colleague of mine, of course, and teaches drama, and was very eager to do some very ambitious plays at the Mount. And so, what did she start me out on? No Exit, I think. Very
yes.
Juicy role.
Mm-hmm.
An Ionesco play about a mad professor. That's very appropriate since I am a professor.
Typecast
at the Mount.
Again, huh?
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
And most unnerving of all, a Michel Tremblay play in which I had to play a transvestite.
Mm-hmm.
That was a real adventure for all concerned.
Sure.
And after that, yes, she launched the Mount Playhouse and our lives were never the same again.
Well, that goes without saying. It takes a great deal of commitment. You're currently teaching English at the Mount, aren't you, Peter?
That's right.
And you're currently the head of the Department of English, so that must make a great take a good chunk of your time.
It does. The Playhouse takes a good chunk of my time too, but it's a different kind of time.
It's volunteer time.
Well, it's volunteer time. It's unpaid time, but it's also escapism, escape time. You get to, if you're sick of your own life, you get to immerse yourself in the life of a completely different kind of a character. And for instance, the character that I'm playing now is a working class Italian who's mad a good deal of the time and makes no bones about it and has a wonderful kind of raunchy energy. And that's good. It's a kind of release from being professorial.
You've done some directing too, of course. In fact,
yes.
I know that you were at one time for 1 year the artistic director of the Playhouse when Mrs. Usmiani took a summer off.
Mm-hmm.
What were some of the pieces that you directed at that time?
Well, we were starting to loan out pieces. We usually gave 6 plays at that time, which is a little ambitious, and we were lending some plays out to guest directors. I think I did 3 plays that that summer, as well as being the overall artistic director. Let's see, Babel Rap, which is a Canadian play.
Play was delightful. I saw it.
On the Tower of Babel, which was a, let me think, it was a kind of construction, one of those construction, what do you call
scaffolding.
Them? Scaffoldings.
Mm-hmm.
Which was made particularly difficult because the lead actress had acrophobia. Heights made her dizzy, even a couple of steps up, so she very nobly had to fight that. The 15-minute Hamlet by Tom Stoppard, in which that monumental play got crammed into 15 minutes. I think, in fact, we usually managed to do it in about 13. Very fast, very cartoony, very complicated. And finally, the most ambitious play of, I think, that season, or perhaps any of the Playhouse season, was Christopher Fry's A Phoenix Too Frequent, which I'm astonished in retrospect that we were able to pull off. But we were, thanks to a wonderful cast who memorized all this blank verse. It's written in poetry, after all, very finely crafted poetry, and they delivered it in a way that made it seem poetic, but not like poetry, not
more
as if they were reciting. Yeah, it was alive, it was supple, it put people in stitches and made them laugh and cry a little bit too, because it's very moving at times. It was one of the high points of my season.
During your years with the Mount Playhouse, Peter, I'm sure you've seen a lot of changes take place in the presentation of, I'm thinking back to the very first year of the Mount Playhouse. As I recall, the stage at that time was lit with the use of a volleyball standard and a spotlight that somebody borrowed from a Christmas tree. Things have come along since then, and I'm wondering about your reflections on a participant over the years, how you've seen it change in other ways. Excuse me.
I'm not even sure that there's a pattern. Every season seems to be a reflection on the previous season, and we kind of do a retreat a little bit and do a little conscience searching and say, how could we have made it better? And we try something different, and then maybe the next year we decide that we would try something different from the previous different thing that we tried. Of course, the overall trend is we've gotten a lot more professional throughout the years. Mm-hmm. No more volleyball standards. The lighting is still far from, you know, elaborate or fluid, but it's a lot better. We were even able to get special effects of various sorts, lamps and mm-hmm. moonlight and so on. I'm thinking of Phoenix Too Frequent, mm-hmm. in fact. I'm amazed that we were able to pull that off.
I remember at the dress rehearsal, I was present at the dress rehearsal, if you'll recall, when the stage almost caught on fire. There are always kinds of pitfalls that make theater exciting.
Yes, indeed.
That was one of the exciting moments. What's another incident, Peter, that keeps you on your toes, that keeps you thinking about what possibly could go wrong?
What possibly could go wrong? Sometimes, actually, if things go wrong, they are the most right thing that can happen, depending on your mood and the audience's mood. I remember in the tenor once when I played the leading role, a very pampered and spoiled opera singer.
Typecast again.
Oh, God. I think I slammed the door and the entire decorative curtain fell down on the stage. Now, what was I going to do? Because in another minute, somebody was supposed to make his entrance and would undoubtedly trip over the curtain and fall into me, and there'd be all kinds of chaos. But since I was supposed to be quite disgusted at the time, I just turned it into an Italian temper tantrum, kicked the curtain off the stage bodily and into the lap of somebody who threw it back on stage, but thank God not all the way on stage. Could have been worse. I could have kicked it right onto their table, upset all the wine glasses, but there's a God in the theater that perhaps watches over us.
Well, obviously he's been looking after you, Peter. I understand that there is also another annual event that takes place as part and parcel of the Playhouse celebrations through the summer. Are you celebrating your 40th birthday again this year?
Again, yes, for the sixth successive time. Right.
Your sixth annual 40th birthday.
Yes.
Well, I understand today is actually the day.
Today is the day, but we may have a surprise party Wednesday.
Warmest felicitations, and actually it'll be a surprise if there isn't a party. I understand that there's a party almost every night at the Mount Playhouse.
Yeah, it's one big party.
One big party. I guess the format has not changed to exclude any sort of participation by the audience in anything that there is to enjoy in the surroundings or in the music, as far as that goes. I think there have been some changes in format, and Susan, you might be able to give us some insight into how things have changed at the Mount, and because you've been involved for a number of years too. Mm-hmm. I know that we do have a clip with us today of the prologue to this year's Wednesday night presentation, which is the farce by Dario Fo. Susan, maybe you could give us just a little bit of information about the We Won't Pay, to help our viewers mm-hmm. out.
Well, it's a fairly recent production by Dario Fo. Takes place in modern-day Italy, 1980s style, and basically concentrates on the working-class man trying to struggle in hard times in a northern Italian town, and how they basically cope with it.
This is the part that Peter plays. He is the, he's mad as hell and he's not going to take it anymore,
yeah.
kind of thing?
Yeah, yeah, he's kind of a pussy, a little bit of a pussy cat, but he surprises us every once in a while with his anger and his wrath and his mm-hmm. contemplative mind.
Mm-hmm. So how many characters are in the piece, Susan?
There is one, two, three, five. Five characters.
And two males and?
Three males, two females.
Don't forget that Chris plays five different roles.
Chris, one of the members of the cast, of course, has about four different roles to play throughout, so he has an awful lot of fast running backstage, costume changes.
So I can see why you hesitate about the number of characters.
Yeah,
in the
we
piece.
Have to. It's hard to keep track of them.
Well, we'll introduce Claudette Sapp, who mm-hmm. I understand is a veteran of the Mount Playhouse, mm-hmm. Who has been with the project from the beginning and is most well known, I think, for her interpretation of Antonin Maillet's La Saguine. However, she takes on an Italian persona in this prologue that we're going to be seeing here coming up in a few moments. Mm-hmm.
I welcome you to Non Si Paga, Non Si Paga. We won't pay, we won't pay. My name is Fulvia Baldi. I'm from the Italian Tourist Bureau. And I've been asked by the Mount Playhouse, because it is an Italian play, to speak to you about Italia and to encourage you to visit my beautiful country. This play takes place in Milano. Ah, oh, Milano. A very beautiful and a very famous city in the north of my country, where one can take part in a very active cultural life of that city. The characters live in a working class neighborhood, but like neighborhoods in your country, you drive through, you wouldn't even notice. But you go to a neighborhood where you see we drive the Ferrari cars and we wear the Gucci shoes. Or like the film stars, Marcello Mastroianni, Giancarlo Giannini, Sofia Loren. We hope to return to Italia after she straightens out her taxes. And tonight's playwright, Dario Fo. Although we're not sure Dario Fo wears the Gucci shoes, he is known in Italia as a very famous TV star, and throughout Europe as a virtuoso performer. He was going to be here tonight, but unfortunately he was refused a visa by your immigration department. He should have come in the boat, huh? A minor foul-up, which we know with your Minister of Culture, who will be much more sympathetic towards the artist, be cleared up in no time. We hope you will enjoy the show. We know you will love the show. And remember, if you are planning a trip to Italia, see me at intermission or after the show, and I will be happy to help you with anything. But airline reservations. In sympathy with the airline traffic controllers in your country, our controllers have decided to show up for work. And it is a very dangerous situation. There are many tours available. One of the most popular in this part of Nova Scotia is the Mediterranean Sea, cradle of civilization and home of the fruit fly. For those of you of the Catholic faith, we have the Cardinal Cody Tour, with all expenses paid for single women over 17.
It was pretty interesting. It's hard for me to picture, though, where this fits into the evening. Susan, when would we see this prologue?
That's presented during the coffee and dessert portion of the evening. And it's rather casual atmosphere. Claudette just sort of strolls in, unbeknownst to anybody in the audience, and does her prologue. And then there's a short break, and we jump into the second.
Does the audience catch on that this is the beginning of the play? I mean, is it something that's obvious to them? I'm thinking that from the way that her mannerisms, I mean, I'm convinced that this woman is a travel agent. And I'm just wondering, have you experienced a reaction from your guests, from your patrons?
Actually, I haven't had too much opportunity to talk to the guests after the play, because I can never manage to get out front and sort of eavesdrop and listen to what everybody has to say. But I plan to do that yet.
Too much running around backstage.
Yeah, this is it.
Well, Susan, I've got to ask you now, a stage manager, what does a stage manager do?
Does a stage manager not do? She doesn't act. That's the only thing she doesn't do.
Not in front of the audience, anyway.
Yeah, at that point. Pretty much you're there at the very beginning during the first reading of the script. And
when would that be? Now, if we're talking about the Mount Playhouse, which
opens
the 1st of July,
right.
So when would this happen?
We start about, around the 1st of May, would you say, Peter? Or a little earlier, even?
I can't get my chronology straight, but it's about a 6-week lead time,
yeah.
I'd say.
Well, when do you hold your, the material is chosen by Renata Yusmiani, mm-hmm. the artistic
mm-hmm.
director,
mm-hmm.
and then what would happen next, I would expect, is you'd have to audition your actors.
Yeah.
So it would be sometime between the end of school at the Mount and the beginning of the rehearsal time. Yeah.
Right.
When
Late
do you
March,
start?
I think.
The end of March, yeah. So you do welcome auditions from the general public as well,
Oh,
you?
Absolutely. The
Great.
More new blood that are involved, the more exciting it is.
Yeah.
It's kind of nice to see some new faces every year, you know, some new talent. Be given an opportunity to get out there and perform.
That's great, and that's happening again this year, I take
yes,
it.
Yes, we've got a few new faces there this year, and a few old ones, of course, I might add, which
is a nice looking
balance.
At anyone in particular.
Another crack about my 40th birthday.
Well, it's your own fault, Peter.
Yeah.
So once you have read the piece and cast the mm-hmm. piece, you begin rehearsals.
We begin rehearsals.
About 6 weeks in advance?
6 weeks prior, yes, to the opening night.
So what is there for a stage manager to do?
Oh, basically getting familiar with the script and the actors and the blocking, writing all the blocking down, where everybody's going to be at what particular time.
So the director determines what the blocking is
and I keep track of it and make sure that the actors are aware of where they're supposed to be.
And that the director sticks to what he said the first time.
Yeah. But it's not always that easy because sometimes people change the blocking.
Mm-hmm.
I can remember one time I missed one of the rehearsals where they were doing the blocking. And I got there and a whole lot of things had changed. And I was there, I take an eraser and I do all the blocking in pencil because it does change a lot. Somebody moves it around quite a bit.
Mm-hmm.
So there's that aspect of it. And
you're really a right hand to the director then, aren't you?
Yeah, pretty much. Pretty much there to help them. And then there's getting all the props and that kind of thing together.
Mm-hmm.
And for this play, I might tell you, it was quite a job.
What are some of the props?
Very unusual props. A coffin, an oxygen tank. Try rabbit heads, for instance.
Rabbit
frozen.
Heads? Frozen
bird
rabbit
seed,
heads.
vegetables, groceries, all kinds of groceries. So an awful lot of stuff.
Well. So this is your responsibility to see that the director is provided with all of these things.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is before the play
this
ever opens.
This is long before. Well, it's supposed to be long before. Sometimes it gets pretty close under the wire. But yeah.
So how often, we're talking about a fair commitment of time
mm-hmm.
here. So what, once or twice a week?
Oh,
or?
Gosh, no more than that.
Depending on who your director is, I'm sure.
Yes, and then how, of course, we're doing a two-act play this year, so there's a lot more time
mm-hmm.
involved, of course,
mm-hmm.
To get that on the road. We're talking about 20 hours a week.
Really?
And then some.
And I understand you've got your hands full the rest of the week as well when you're not being a stage
mm-hmm.
manager. You look after children.
Yes.
How many children do you have right now?
Well, summer's here, so I've only have a few, thank heavens. I've got about five.
And what do
winter
you know in the wintertime?
Wintertime is a lot more.
Yeah.
Or has been, yeah.
So how do you manage with the kids while you're
Well, sometimes I bring them to rehearsals.
Mm-hmm.
Mostly we schedule our rehearsals during nights and weekends, so
mm-hmm.
I don't have too much.
I understand you even brought one today.
Yes, she's out there somewhere.
Little Becky, she's being a good girl, too. And you've got Michael and Sarah at home, your own children.
Yes.
So, well, you're a very busy girl. How did you get roped into the Mount Playhouse, Sue?
Well, it's kind of by accident. It was a good friend of mine who was quite involved in the theater, producing it, asked me to join in 1 year and help with some backstage work, which I did. And I guess it got into my blood, and the next year I got really involved and worked with Peter Schwenger, actually, on one of his plays that he was directing. I stage managed with him then.
Right.
And I've been there every year ever since. Just can't seem to get away from it.
Yeah. Well, you must enjoy it.
Yes, it's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Sometimes I curse about it and I, mm-hmm. you know, kind of wish I could break away, but once I get out there, I have to tell you, I enjoy it.
Well, it's a lot of responsibility, and
mm-hmm.
I suppose you have to be prepared for every eventuality.
Mm-hmm.
What is your nightmare? What is the stage manager's nightmare? What's the worst
Which
thing
Which one? Which nightmare?
The one. Okay,
well,
in order of priority then.
I guess it would be something happening to one of the actors and,
mm-hmm.
and them not showing up. We don't have any understudies.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm certainly not going to get out there. So I'm afraid that might happen at some point where somebody doesn't show up and, okay, there you go, so get on mm-hmm. stage. And Just mm-hmm. work your way through it.
Now, tell me the truth. Had you never, ever thought that you might get on stage?
I think about it every year. I think, well, maybe this year I'll audition for something. And then I quickly changed my mind, and I prefer the background work, mm-hmm. behind the scenes.
Maybe next year you might?
Maybe. Yeah. Who knows? Anything
How many
happen.
Years have you been saying that?
Four.
Well, obviously, Sue, you must be doing a crackerjack job. Now, I'm going to ask Peter for some insight into the role of a stage manager from a director's point of view. Now, mm-hmm. well, do you think Sue is on the beam here with what she's talking about as far
gosh,
as
gosh, yes. I remember the difference that Sue made when she first took that job as stage manager for the Boer. It was a Russian play, a farcical thing. And it was just like day and night. I had the year before, I remember directing
Phoenix
Too Frequent and having things happen like blocking a whole complicated scene, arriving the next night and realizing that I'd been so busy blocking it and everyone had been so busy acting it that nobody had written it down and we would have to do the whole thing all over again. And suddenly everything just fit in smoothly. It was just a godsend. I was so grateful to have her.
And it's nice to know somebody appreciates me.
It wasn't just, you know, that like she was taking dictation either. I mean, I think one of the things you might consider, Sue, besides acting, is actually directing.
Yes.
Because Sue would every so often, you know, leap in and say, are you sure you want to do it this way? Or why don't you do it this way? Or isn't it more likely that she would think this? And she was generally dead on. It was really interesting to have another kind of artistic mind to contribute and to sort of huddle with and also a shoulder to cry on every
we
so
do
often.
That once in a while.
Well, now, Sue, there you go. For next season, it's going to have to be flipping a coin.
Oh, right, acting or directing,
acting,
huh?
Acting or directing, yeah.
Thanks, Peter.
But I'm sure where you're good at stage managing, that you probably would be too valuable to give up to the more frivolous directing or acting ends of things. Really, it sounds as though you form a very important cog in the whole machine for the Playhouse. What do you do now when the curtain actually goes up after the major trauma of mm-hmm. opening is over, the technical and the dress mm-hmm. rehearsals have taken place. Mm-hmm. You've opened the show. Now what do you do for the rest of the run? Which is 6 weeks, I guess.
Yes, it is, yeah. Well, I'm backstage throughout the performance itself and giving cues to the actors, making sure they're ready, anything they need. And as I said earlier, Chris, one of the actors, has about four costume changes, and some of them are really quick. We don't have a whole lot of time to get him into costumes and get his phony mustache on and that kind of thing. So I'm back there helping him a lot, and basically making sure the actors have the props that they need to get on stage and off again.
Who assists you now, Sue? I mean, I understand you have a house manager?
I have a house manager. Sarah MacFarlane is there too. She takes care of the front of the house. And Kathleen Crawley is our lights and sound technician, as well as my assistant stage director, stage manager. And she's been a real
See,
godsend.
See, did you catch that Freudian slip? She almost said director.
So she's just been absolutely wonderful. I don't know a whole lot about the lights and the technical aspect of it, so it's really nice to know that there's other people to depend on when you need them.
That's great. So you've got how many weeks left in the run? Several, you're about halfway through.
We're halfway through. We have three more weeks to go, yeah.
And do you foresee any major catastrophes?
Well, I'm not a prophet, but I feel quite good about it right now. We've gotten through, I would say the first 2 weeks were the toughest, opening night, of course, mm-hmm. and the second week, you know, again, we weren't all that, I guess, confident at that point. It takes a while. And I feel fairly confident about the whole thing right now. Everybody's quite comfortable. They're more into their roles, and I think it'll be smooth sailing right in.
Well, as I understand, this is a year of change for the Mount mm-hmm. Playhouse. Just to back up a bit for the sake of our viewers, the Mount Playhouse was the first dinner theater of its kind in Eastern
right.
Canada.
Yeah.
And it's now in its sixth year of production. Since that time, there have been a number of imitations by the professional theater community here in the city, involving professional actors, professional musicians, and stage managers, mm-hmm. directors, and so on. I'm wondering how that's affected the operation of the Mount Playhouse, and just perhaps as two individuals who have been connected with the Playhouse from its beginning, in Sue's case, and certainly from its beginning in Peter's, how do you see the Mount responding to what is in fact a divided market now, when you think of the number of dinner theaters and out-of-town mm-hmm. summer theater that's being offered now. Mm-hmm. How do you think the Mount's going to react to that? Do you think there's going to be some more change? What do you think is going to happen, Peter?
I think one thing won't change. I've mentioned that we've tried different things as far as the performance goes, or the format of the performances or of the evening. But there's a certain spirit in the Playhouse. I think this may sound silly, but it has a lot to do with the room in which all this takes place. The Mount St. Vincent Pub is a smallish kind of room. The audience is right on top of a smallish kind of stage. There's a lot of involvement. There's an easygoing atmosphere so that you don't feel as if you're just kind of isolated or plunked down in a little glass cage watching mm-hmm. a play just mm-hmm. for you. There's a kind of feeling that the whole room comes together and people end up table hopping, getting to know other
yes.
people. Or if they don't, you know, introduce themselves, they actually feel part of a whole spirit. They wander out on the terrace, and it's homier, I think, than some of the other.
I think you would agree with that.
Yes, I do. Yeah, I think they're quite right there. One of the things about the Mount Playhouse, as Peter said, the audience is almost a part of some of the scenes. A lot of our scenes take place within the audience, and they love it. They mm-hmm. love the fact that that the actors are moving in and out amongst them. As a matter of fact, the other night I had to warn a couple of the audience that one of the scenes would be taking place right in front of their nose, and they were just delighted, absolutely delighted. And there's another scene where Peter and Steve Martin, one of the actors, not Steve Martin, but Steve Martin, and
the
they had to bring
a
coffin into the Playhouse, in through the audience, and it's quite a tight little area.
Well,
there's
I'm
a few
sure
moments
you
where, you know, oh gosh, I hope they don't bash that guy.
Well,
on
I know
the head.
One thing that in concluding our talk today about the Mount Playhouse, I know that there are several things that make the Mount Playhouse unique. First of all, in its brand of sophisticated drama, because it does come from a university, and it's offering drama that perhaps might not be offered elsewhere. Mm-hmm. Thank you both so much for coming today and speaking with me about the Mount Playhouse. And as a note to our viewers, tickets for the remaining performances of the Mount Playhouse can be obtained by calling the university at 443-4450, extension 354. And thank you for joining me today on In Town. I'm Dilly MacFarlane, thanking Peter Schwenger, Susan Stainton, and thanking you for joining me today.